we'll get back to Tom and me and some of the struggles, some of his struggles with uncertainty about his big plan. What is your plan for the future use of alcohol?
I will never drink again.
How's that feel?
Scary.
Are you taking your deep breaths?
Yeah.
What are the feelings? What are these feelings?
Because it's unsure.
Are you?
Yes, I am. I'm very unsure of it right now. But I will never drink again.
You don't know? There it is. There it is.
Honestly, I don't.
You feel it struggling for its life here. It's damn near dead. It's a living thing. It's begging for mercy.
I can't. I can't give it any mercy. I have to do this, Jack.
Yeah. You ever going to drink again?
I will never drink again.
Boy. Yeah, look here now. Tom? Look here. Is that you crying or it?
It.
It cries.
It's making me suffer right now.
Because now, wait, stop. You say it's making you suffer?
That's how I feel.
Wait a minute. It is suffering.
But it's part of me.
How much a part of you is it?
Very little right now because I'm going to beat it.
Okay. It looks to me like it is scared shitless. It sees something coming down. Like it's like death row. It's afraid of you, Tom. Do you understand that?
Yes.
It knows something about you. You are not clear about it all. Do you know what it knows about you?
Dude, I'm not sure about this.
Nuh-uh. That's what it's telling you. This is the big bluff. Now, if I have a gun here, and I'm holding it on you, but you know it's an empty gun. It has no bullets in it. How do you feel?
No danger.
No danger. But there I go. It got a bullet. There's danger. And you're scared shitless. Does your beast think that you are firing blanks?
Not right now, no.
It knows that you are loaded. It's
serious as hell.
Yeah. It knows that you're entirely capable. Otherwise, it would not be afraid. It would be laughing. It would be snickering. But it's crying, Tom.
Because I know I can beat it.
It knows that you can beat it in a heartbeat. With no effort. That's what it knows about you, but it keeps you in the dark. Keeps telling you, I'm more powerful than you are. I'll get you. I'll get you. You can't say that. It's afraid, Tom, because it doesn't have any hands. It knows that you have to pour. That you're serving. It knows that you're serving.
If I choose not to serve, it loses.
And it cries. It cried last night. Mm-hmm. It's crying now. It's defenseless. Your beast is powerless. And it's crying because it knows that it's powerless. It's dragged you through a lot of shit. It's caused you a lot of misery. It comes on like a friend. Have mercy, have mercy. Do you hate your beast?
Yes.
So, Tom, what is your plan for the future use of alcohol.
I'll never drink again, Jack.
What do you hear?
Peace.
Quiet in there. It's quiet. Where is it? Where did it go?
I don't know.
I can tell you, it's lurking. It's just there. It's there.
It doesn't have a choice.
It doesn't have choices.
None.
It has no choice. It must do what it does. Mm-hmm. When it does what it does, it proves that you are in good health. This is a robust drive. This is the force of life that fears death, and you can feel the fear. Mm-hmm. But the force of life has gotten channeled into a pursuit, a dance with death, by drinking alcohol. Your body has made a mistake, but that does not mean that your body is sick.
Right.
You have a healthy, robust, nothing wrong with it. You can be proud of your family tree. You guys did not inherit the problem.
Alcoholism, no.
It's you've inherited, you've inherited the solution to mm-hmm. it. You've inherited the strength and the ability and the intelligence and the capacity to defeat the rap, to beat the rap.
Mm-hmm. Yes. It's so simple, Jack.
So simple.
I feel like I've taken leaps and bounds in 2 days here. And I know I can win.
How long will it take you to get your act completely together on this?
I don't know. As to controlling the drinking and you know, keeping it out of my life, I can do that right now.
Are you completely recovered then from your addiction?
I don't know right now. Only because...
Are you going to drink anymore?
No.
What does recovery from addiction consist of?
Only what I've been told for years. It takes time, day at a time. You can never be recovered. Uh-huh. You are always an alcoholic, okay? Yeah. That's what's been programmed in my brain.
This is all AB. One day at a time, you're always an alcoholic. It's all addicted voice.
I don't want that in my life anymore. Yeah. I got to get that out of my mind,
This
Jack.
Is the recovery group disorder.
Yeah.
You became infected. In these groups, this is a contagious... The disease concept is the disease, if you could follow that.
Mm-hmm. And I don't think I have a disease anymore.
How sure are you of that?
Absolutely positive.
Maybe AA's right. They got a lot of doctors in there.
No, with AA.
A lot of MDs now. These MDs ought to know.
No. This is something that is within every person, period, and they can battle it and do it themselves.
Why can some people
deal with it themselves?
Some people can just take it or leave it, and
mm-hmm.
you know.
Mm-hmm.
Something different about you, what is it?
Because I choose to take it too far.
Ask me the same question.
What's different about you, Jack? Why can't you just take it or leave it?
Because those people don't know how to drink. I just don't know how to do it. I do. They didn't drink the right stuff in the right amounts and space it the way that I could.
Mm-hmm.
And it was stupid, it was harmful, it was destructive, it was a whole lot of other things. But it was also very gratifying, very pleasant. I have very vivid recollections of that pleasure. I can still, even as I tell this right now, I can re-experience some of that pleasure, the euphoria of it all. Lois doesn't know how to do that. She has a drink, and she says, "Well, it makes my head feel funny. I don't like that. Take it away."
Mm-hmm.
If she has two drinks, she'll get sick.
Mm.
So she's impaired in her ability to drink, mm-hmm. as I can drink. Due to some physiological problem that she has. We may as well call that the disease of alcoholism. Can't handle the stuff. I can't. I know how to drink. See, that there's semantics here. And there's a funny way that we've learned to start talking about people who say, I can't drink. I just can't drink. When it's one of the things they do best. They drink and drink and drink, and they can drink. The problem is they can drink, not that they can't. And so we need to get rid of this idea that we are out of control when we're doing something deliberate and very skillfully. When you think of it, we know what to buy, how to pour it, how to ration it out, schedule it.
So you don't get hammered all of a sudden.
Right, you make preparations you can, for tomorrow, right, never run can, out. Right.
So that is very in control of the situation.
That's right.
Wow.
So we can also choose to stop doing that.
Yes.
Instead of rolling over and copying a disease and say, hey, I'm not responsible.
I've got a disease, I'm not responsible for my actions. Right. You're exactly responsible for every move you've made.
Yeah. We don't have a disease to forgive us for what we did.
No.
You can't blame mama.
No.
Can't blame your genes. You can't even blame the recovery group
anymore.
It's
a disease. It's all on me now. And it makes it so much easier to handle that way.
Yeah. You said that you're never going to drink again. How confident are you with that?
Now?
At this point in the game, yeah.
Very confident.
Like on a scale of 0 okay. to 100% confidence, where would you rank your confidence right now?
50. I know that's not a lot.
That's toss of the coin.
I know.
Toss of the coin.
I know. I don't want to set myself up, you know?
Do you want to have a crapshoot?
No, I don't, Jack.
A nickel toss?
No, I don't.
Your life is on one side of the nickel and the beast's life is on the other side of the nickel.
No.
Yeah. Let's roll it and see who wins here.
Oh, okay. Hold on. When it comes to that, I know I won't drink again, period. Because I'm not going to let the beast ever take over again or ever tell me what to do, Jack. You know what? I'm not 50% confident. I'm 100% confident that I will never drink again, Jack.
You went
Jack.
From 50
I know,
to 100 here.
Because
this
I didn't realize...
Remarkable.
I didn't realize what you were saying though. I for some reason I didn't even think
How
about.
Confident
am I going to allow the beast to take over? No.
No.
I am in control of me. Mm-hmm. That's how confident I am. I am in control. I understand exactly what I have to do now. What I can do.
How do you know you won't change your mind?
Because I've decided. Because I know I've decided to quit drinking, to stop it, to quit, eat it out of my life. I will never drink again. And that's what I've decided now.
You can say that now.
Yes, I can now. And I can say it in the future, too.
You can know the future.
No, I don't. But I know I won't drink in the future.
How do you know? How do you know? How do you know?
Because I've decided.
Yeah. Well, a lot of people have decided that they won't do it anymore.
Mm-hmm.
Mark Twain says, I've quit 1,000 times. It's easy. It's easy to quit. I've quit 1,000 times.
Yeah. That's one of my favorite things to say to myself. Used to be.
Now so what's different now? What's going on here?
The person who I am is different. What I'm finding out, what I'm learning here.
Did you get a new driver's license to account for that change?
No.
No? Well, what's
Didn't,
going
on? I'm still the same guy.
Oh.
Still the same guy. I just have new tools.
Yeah.
That's all. I have new tools to apply to my life, thanks to you and this whole program. And all I know is from now on in my life, I don't want to drink. If things change in the future, which I have no idea if they will or not, Jack, and I have no control over that, all I know is I will tell myself that I will never drink again.
You said on one hand, you don't know the future.
Right.
There needs to be some way to pin this down so that you can feel perfectly confident.
That's what I'd like. I don't know how, though.
So what's this? There's a loose end here. What is it?
I don't know. The beast saying, hey, you know what? You're not completely in control yet, maybe.
Maybe?
Maybe I'm not. I don't know. All I know is that I'm going to try to apply everything I'm learning here to my life and keep the control of my life instead of letting the beast run my life.
You think that this is more hoping than knowing?
Yes, I do.
You're hoping this is true. You're hoping that you're 100% competent.
Yeah. How will I ever know, Jack?
Oh, you can know. It's easy. And this is what we're doing right now, is we're getting all the burrs off the edges of this new thing. It's just been installed and has some ragged edges. And this doubt, we have a number of, this is AVRT, the techniques involved. We have a number of very good ways. Any one of them can polish it off perfectly. We can do it over and over again and get a perfect sheen on the big plan.
And a complete confidence?
100%. I mean, total, okay. This is perfection. AVRT is perfect logic. Some people go the moral route. You're of the opinion that it's wrong to drink for you.
Yes.
For you to drink.
Definitely.
And I asked you, how wrong is it? You were able to rank it very high.
Yes.
This is about the top of the stack of wrong things to do. And that alone, when you connect it to this thing about doubt, goes a long ways. And for some people, it says,
excuse me,
he's like, there are certain things that I am incapable of voluntarily doing. And some people have a long list of things that they would rather take a bullet and would willingly, gladly take a bullet before they would voluntarily do.
Mm-hmm.
I think you have a list of things that you, if I was holding this mythical gun, I said, I want you to do this. You'd say, take your best shot. Because I'm coming at you, but I won't do that.
Right.
I won't do that. It could have to do with patriotism. It could have to do with life and death. Or things that are too ugly and disgusting to even think of.
Mm-hmm.
But when push comes to shove, most of us have a few things, at least, that we will not do purely because it's wrong. It's wrong. It's wrong. It's against everything that we stand for.
Mm-hmm.
That can be the main keystone of a big plan.
Mm.
I know that I won't do it. I don't know what I will do in the future, but I'll tell you one thing.
No, I know what I won't do.
I won't be doing.
Yeah. I'm starting to understand a little bit better.
Yeah, I can't predict the future. I don't even know where I'm going to do this. Where am
but
I going
to? But
I
know what I won't do. I see what you're saying, though.
Yeah, no matter where
there's a morality thing there where I know I won't. There's a list of things I just will not do.
Yes.
And I'm going to have to just understand that I'm putting this on that list.
Yeah, that's it. You add this to that list.
Yes.
You got it. Okay, that's it.
I'm going to add this to that list.
Exactly. There's that list, and these are the ultimate no-nos.
I can do that.
Yeah, because we're human.
Yeah, I can do that. Now, with the decision as to I will never drink again, that list disappeared.
Your moral inventory disappeared.
It's gone. And that's because I would want to do those, or those would occur or happen while I was drinking.
Preparing to drink, or covering up your drinking.
Right, or covering up, or lying about my drinking.
Yeah.
Now that I've decided that I will never drink again, and that's going to be my future plan 100%, that moral list of things that I said I'd never do, they're not even, they're not relevant.
Yeah. Because you become a moral person.
Yeah.
When you do not drink, and you know you're not going to drink.
The final thing out of my life.
You trust yourself to be a decent, moral person.
Exactly.
So this is, to sum this up now, this is the exchanging the entire moral inventory for the moral principle that it's wrong to drink.
Yeah. That's I can fall off the wagon and still be a good person.
See, when Dr. Bob got together, this was the pact that we are not responsible. It is not wrong. We don't have to feel guilty and morally responsible for our conduct. Mm-hmm. And around that, it's like the concentric circles.
All built around exactly
all
that.
All built around that inversion of truth. So everything is upside down.
None of these people even realize that they are responsible for their own actions.
Exactly. And that they are surrendering their lives to the beast, which keeps them in place there. Mm-hmm. And they come and worship the beast several times a week, saying, "Before thee, O mighty beast, I am powerless." When they have the drunkologue sharing, this is howling at the moon.
Yeah.
The call of the wild, when they talk about the past drunks and they leave there and say, "The only time I want to drink is after those meetings." And they do drink.
Mm-hmm.
The call of the wild is awakened at every meeting. The beast howls at the moon. How does it feel to be recovered?
I feel absolutely wonderful. That I feel like a weight has been lifted off my shoulders.
Yeah.
Because I'm not so concerned anymore about if I'm going to do the right thing.
Yeah.
Because I don't have to drink.
You trust
I'm not
yourself.
Drinking. Yes, I can trust myself completely without the alcohol in my
exactly.
life.
Exactly. Yeah.
I have a great life. I have a great future. I have
hope.
Yes.
Do you remember how you've learned how to look through the eyes of addiction, through the eyes of the beast?
Yes.
Take a look at your life now through the eyes of your beast. No booze.
So it's not going to be very much fun.
No.
So it's going to be pretty boring.
Boring.
Yeah. You won't be able to party. You won't be able to have fun.
No fun? How about a trip to the mountains? How will that be?
That's hard because I love going to the mountains, going hiking. The beast does. That's hard because I love going to the mountains, going hiking. The beast does, but he is already looking forward to that drink afterwards.
Yeah.
That's not going to happen anymore, though.
So how does your beast feel about a trip to the mountains?
Says, to hell with it, let's go have a drink.
Feel, what feeling does it have?
To me.
Toward about going up to the mountains?
It's going to be boring. It's not going to be any fun.
You see that?
Mm-hmm.
Yeah. That's the truth of the matter, is that your beast has no interest in anything, unless you're drinking, and then everything is interesting.
Mm-hmm.
Watching a sunset can be wonderful for your beast if you have a drink in your hand. No drink, what does the beast see when it looks out to the horizon?
Boring.
Yeah, it doesn't perceive beauty for its own sake.
Mm-hmm.
It only experiences pleasure through the use of alcohol.
Mm-hmm.
And relationships with people.
Relationships with people, it's going to be boring again because everybody I know drinks.
Mm-hmm.
And it's not going to be fun anymore, period.
No fun.
Yeah.
All these people are going to wonder what's wrong with you.
Mm-hmm. Why have you stopped drinking?
Why?
Do you have a serious problem? You going to AA?
What's wrong with you?
Yeah, I'm going to hear a lot of that.
Yeah, your beast is really concerned about that.
Mm-hmm.
But through your eyes, when you switch now, you shift over.
Right.
And take a look at that situation. What do you see?
I see all sorts of other options. I see all sorts of fun, interesting things to do, to experience.
Watching people get drunk, you mean?
That's going to be the funny part, actually. You know, watching them.
It's ridiculous. because your beast is over here whining and moaning, oh, these people, they don't want me to drink, oh, and they're going to think I'm something wrong with me. And then you shift into your right mind, which you've had all along, by the way, it's just right there. You shift into your right mind, and it's absurd.
Yes, it really is.
Who cares if they want you to drink?
Exactly. It doesn't matter.
Why would anyone want you to drink?
To be part of the crowd.
Yeah.
You know? How are they let everybody whoop it up. Let's see you relax. They always say, well, you want to, come on, cut loose, man. So,
why do you think they want you to drink?
Because I'm so uptight.
How do you think they feel if you don't drink?
Very uncomfortable.
Uptight.
Yes.
So, do you see here there's an inversion?
Instead of them feeling uptight, they want me to cut loose so they don't feel uptight anymore.
Exactly. Right? They don't give a hoot how you feel. No. But they do not want you to cast a shadow on them.
That's it. Wow. You know, I'm going to have a hell of a night tonight. I got a company party to go to.
Yeah.
And,
your beast has really been sweating it.
Yeah, he has. He's like, okay, what am I gonna do here?
It's gonna be hard.
Yes, yes. And now I feel totally different about it.
Yeah,
it's gonna be hilarious. I'm gonna have a good time.
You know you will.
Yeah.
Yeah. And if everybody's drinking too much, what are you gonna do?
Yeah, I'd still be me. Exactly what I am.
Do you like being around drunk people?
No, I'll probably leave.
That's exactly the point. When it gets to a certain point, what they do is not funny.
Right.
It stops being funny.
Yes. Tonight's going to be interesting.
Yeah, and you have a privilege to circulate as you see fit.
Mm-hmm. Mm-hmm.
Stay away from the characters you don't like to be around.
Right.
Some of the people who drink, you may just like to be around.
Mm-hmm.
Drunk or sober, you may just like them. And you can hang out with anybody you want to without ever fearing that you would do something that for you is wrong.
It's so simple to say that I'm done.
You see how the beast grabbed you?
It
grabbed
it
you by the throat.
It said, no, you're not going to say that.
It grabbed you by the throat. Don't you say that.
It's so simple to say that I'm done.
Do you see how the beast grabbed you?
It
by,
did.
It grabbed it you by the throat.
It just stopped me and said, no, you're not going to say that.
It grabbed you by the throat. Don't you say that.
I'm completely recovered, Jack.
You know you are.
Yeah.
Obviously.
Yes, I do.
Yeah. You're right on schedule, by the way. This is the second day. We want everyone to complete the recovery during the second day.
I had no idea that was the plan, but...
Yeah, that's the plan. We do it on the second day, and the third day, and fourth day. You may wonder what we do, but it just gets better.
That's what I want, I'm totally confident. I have the confidence, 100%.
Yeah.
And only because of what you've taught me here.
I want you to give yourself a bit more credit. It was very easy to teach you. Because it seemed to me that you knew all this in the first place.
Kind of.
But you would not...
I didn't know how to grasp it and get a hold of
it. Make it your own thinking.
Right.
That was it. You knew all this stuff. You knew. You know it's wrong to drink.
Yep.
You know that you have the choice.
Yep.
You know that it's wrong to do it one day at a time.
Yeah.
It's like getting divorced one day at a time. You're married. You're still married if you're divorced one day at a time. Yeah. That's not the way you quit anything.
No.
And you've known this.
Mm-hmm.
But there's a part of you that is extremely vulnerable to this kind of screwed up thinking. The beast, its whole persona, thrives on that kind of thinking, and it's dignified by doctors and social workers and psychologists and sponsors and all these wonderful, nice people, Betty Ford people.
Yeah, yeah. So it screwed my whole thinking up, though. See, I could not get past that because everybody was telling me I'm wrong for trying to do it on my own or trying to do it, you know, for myself.
Right. Now, the professional community in America is keeping an entire nation
addicted under a thumb
to alcohol and drugs.
Yes.
And they're also waging a war on the very people that they are keeping in that condition mm-hmm. under a war on drugs and using that to transform our society into something that wasn't intended to be.
I've tried every damn system there is to try, every kind of meeting, group, personal, you know, rehabilitation, even with psychiatrists all the way down to counselors.
And how do you feel about all this? You've trusted doctors, you've trusted the groups, you've trusted these people and said, look, I have a problem. I'm coming to you because I want your advice, I want your guidance, I want your help.
I feel completely misled all the way, all the way.
If someone rips you off...
I was betrayed my entire life.
Okay, if you've been betrayed, ripped off, misguided
mm-hmm.
by the professional people mm-hmm. and the recovery
group... The ones you're supposed to trust.
How do you feel about that?
Anger.
In the recovery group, what does it mean if you're angry? Remember HALT? H-A-L-T? Did you ever hear that?
Yes.
What is H-A-L-T?
That's what they say that you are going to experience before you relapse or that's during it. Your period of
HALT.
Relapse.
Yeah, if you ever feel hungry, angry, lonely, or tired, HALT.
Right.
Stop. I'm in relapse. I have to run to a meeting.
Yes.
I have to call my sponsor.
Yes.
And be very careful. Because if I don't do those things, I'll drink again. Oh. What we have here is that the conditions for drinking are injected into every one day at a time.
Yes.
Every day is loaded
with
H-A-L-T,
relapse.
Hungry, angry, and tired. And if your life, if you're being ripped off with this powerlessness and one day at a time stuff and get angry about it, and that just means that you are sicker than others. Some are sicker than others. And you have resentments. That you are angry. These are alcoholic emotions, and you will drink again. This is how...
So they've been telling us for
all
these years.
This is how they pathologize dissent.
Mm-hmm.
If you're a dissenter and don't believe it and resist it and question it and challenge it, you're angry. You're just being angry. You have resentments. You're going to drink again. Okay, in rational recovery, we help people or encourage people to cherish your anger. It's an inner voice of indignation that you have been misguided,
yes,
misled, that your life has been wasted,
yes,
going down the garden path with mm-hmm. these losers. And the fact that it was supported, endorsed by medical doctors and psychologists and social workers is a very serious problem.
Yes,
you
it
have
is.
A right to be angry that the professions have embraced something that is so patently false and harmful. It's just like we've taken to wrapping wounds in filthy rags.
Mm-hmm.
It's an infection. When you tell addicted people that they are powerless over the desire to get mm-hmm. drunk, it's the worst thing. Now, for all of those years, has anyone ever said, you should quit drinking once and for all?
No. Nobody wants. You should try it day at a time. That's all I ever heard. Try a day at a time. And if you relapse, it's okay.
This is why we keep saying over and over that AA is the embodiment of the beast of
that's
addiction
true.
And all the program things that
AA,
they have.
AA, NA, Al-Anon, you know,
yeah,
Aquarian
all
efforts,
the programming,
everything.
The 12-step
yes.
program and all the counseling that they do is the human voice of the beast, the addictive voice.
Right.
That's what it is. Because the system tolerates
mm-hmm.
drinking
mm-hmm.
and expects
it's like a home
people.
For it.
It is a home. We couldn't have found a worse solution than we picked up on.
That's for sure. I've experienced it for the last 20 years. And the depression that you feel when you walk out of those meetings, it never helped me.
Never. It made you worse.
It did.
Yeah.
It made me hate myself. You know, these people, they walk into those meetings, they don't like themselves. You have to I'm walking out of here liking who I am.
Mm-hmm.
Understanding who I am, understanding exactly what I have to deal with in my life, okay? The information wasn't there for the other programs.
Yeah, this thing about liking yourself is interesting because there's some forms of addiction treatment will help you to build self-esteem. You're familiar with that?
Mm-hmm.
And the idea is that if you like yourself and respect yourself, then you'll not want to drink.
Yeah, it's kind of an idea.
You won't have the need to cope with your low self-esteem by drinking all this alcohol. And the interesting thing is that I haven't said a word about it here.
Mm-mm.
I'm a shrink, but I don't do that here.
Right.
But I've never talked about your self-esteem, yet you are saying, now that I've quit drinking, I like myself. You see the inversion here.
Mm-hmm.
What they're doing in the addiction treatment field is saying, well, let's fix up your self-esteem so that you don't drink.
It is inverted completely. You stop drinking, then you will feel better about yourself, period.
Exactly. And it's so simple. But we have an entire industry on building self-esteem, you've heard new coping mechanisms, new social skills, and that'll take away or reduce
anger,
the desire.
Anger and grief management. And one of the things that really gets me about Alcoholics Anonymous.
Mm-hmm. Where you confess at the town square.
Anonymous my ass. But the name is just the opposite of what the purpose is. Everything. But all they're doing is hiding every single bit of it.
Everything is inverted upside down.
Exactly.
Black is
it's
white.
It's totally opposite
white is black,
of what it should be.
Up is down, down is up.
Now, having a belief in a higher power, they say that they're not religious.
What is the higher power in Alcoholics Anonymous?
Supposedly, you're supposed to find your own higher power.
When you are living in the
group.
Voice, what do you think the higher power is?
The group, usually.
Well, in the step number one, what do they say about, what's that? Step number one is, I am powerless
over alcohol. Right.
So what's the higher power?
The alcohol.
Alcohol. The addiction, whatever the addiction is.
The addiction,
is,
whatever you're addicted to, right.
Powerless over the desire to get high.
Yeah.
That's all they're saying. And because we are so powerless over the desire to get high, we will come and worship the beast 3 times a week.
How come people can't see this? How come they're just not seeing it, Jack?
Here's why. Now, let me answer that. You've already been doing shifting here.
Yes.
When you look through the eyes of addiction, it looks okay.
Mm-hmm.
When you get in your right mind, it's crazy.
Yes.
You look at alcohol through the eyes of addiction, it looks good.
That's wonderful.
You get in your right mind, and it's
you see it
disgusting.
It is.
So when you hear people saying, I'm powerless over my addiction, it sounds good to the addicted person because that means that they do not have to feel guilty about any of the harm they've caused. It means that they are excused for all their past drinking, all their future drinking is excused, as long as you call it a relapse.
Mm-hmm.
And you only stay sober one day at a time. Now tell your beast right now, I'm just going to stay sober today, and I don't know about tomorrow.
No, my beast would be screaming, you know what, tomorrow you're drinking, buddy.
Exactly.
I know exactly how it would be if I told myself that.
The beast keeps people at bay.
Yeah.
See? The beast has them all at bay, and the people are huddled
mm-hmm.
with their wagons in a circle, with the beast howling to keep them tightly packed into these groups. And that's what's going on. It's the embodiment of the beast. It's one of the greatest health catastrophes in human history, perpetrated by a national government, and exported to other nations. And international tensions exist because we feel like victims of countries where the peasants produce cash crops of drugs.
Heroin, right.
We feel like victims because we see it as a disease.
It is an addiction.
It's a vice.
Correct.
And if people can drink without creating harm to others or even themselves, then so be it. But when a pattern develops of harm, then it's time to grow up.
Mm-hmm.
Grow up and stop. You leave these childish things behind.
Mm-hmm.
The effect of your recovery, the experience of actually popping out, which is what you've done. I mean, you just sort of popped out of your addiction.
I kind of feel, too.
Yeah, and it feels wonderful.
Yeah.
And then we've already identified that to your beast, it doesn't look so wonderful.
No.
Yeah, it's very sad, and it whines, and it cries. Yes. Poor thing. To drink or not to drink? That is the question. There's two of you,
mm-hmm.
and then there's only two possible yes or no.
Mm-hmm.
Like there's I and it,
mm-hmm.
beast, and it's either yes or no.
Mm-hmm.
So we have only four possibilities.
Mm-hmm.
And you can find yourself at any given time somewhere on these four squares. For example, last night. If you said this was me last night. Exactly. That's the lower right quadrant.
If I would have said yes, though, it would have been just I would have been disgust. This is what I see in disgust.
Yeah, and that's you.
Yeah.
Yeah. If the answer is yes, I'm going to drink.
And it's like,
oh no, Jesus, my life.
Man, what am I doing? Depressing. You know? Right. But the beast is screaming, yeah, man, this is what I really want.
That's the smirking presence. Yeah. You have the relapse. Whoopee, it's party mm-hmm. time. Break out the booze. Now, see, these two quadrants here mm-hmm. are sad faces.
Yeah.
This is the very unfortunate thing that happens in addiction treatment and recovery, is that people get really depressed. You get more and more depressed.
Yeah.
Because they keep bouncing back and forth between upper left and lower right. And now up here, upper left, is relapse anxiety.
Right.
That's okay. What this is here. Oh, right. My God, I might drink again. How do I feel secure?
Mm-hmm.
There but by the grace of God go I. I don't know.
And then when they do say no to the drink, they're still
depressed.
Same, right.
Exactly. So they have two
double whammy.
Equally intolerable alternatives here. Yeah. This is depression. When you don't drink, your beast gets very depressed.
Mm-hmm.
And then you think of drinking, and that's depressing. So you seem to be caught on an axis between the frying pan and the fire.
Right.
And this is why people cluster together in these recovery groups, huddling together, hugging each other, desperately clinging to each other, going to meeting after meeting, day after day, 90 and 90. Well, that's crazy. But they're scared to death of the bodily desires that come with being a human being.
Mm-hmm.
They're afraid of their own bodily desires. Now, when you see here, let's get out of the no.
Mm-hmm.
No, I will never drink again. Then you can see that this is recovery. This is yes. The end of the addiction.
Yes.
So this is the matrix.
Mm-hmm.
And it's a very handy thing. It suddenly unravels this whole illusion that's going on behind the scenes to make the recovery group possible. You've heard the expression, dry drunk.
Oh, yeah.
Point to the dry drunk. Dry drunk. Dry drunk.
I don't know. It would have to be the...
What are dry drunks like?
They still have the same process of living their lives without drinking, though.
Yeah, well, how do they feel most of the time?
Depressed.
Yes.
You know?
Okay. Yeah, dry drunks are miserable.
This kind of angry little guys, you know?
Yeah. Angry?
Mm-hmm.
That's pathologizing anger, which mm-hmm. I mentioned before.
Mm-hmm.
They're depressed.
Mm-hmm.
They are irritable.
Mm-hmm.
They are incapable of having fun.
Mm-hmm.
Now, a little bit ago...
I thought I was that for a long time.
Yeah, but see, a little bit ago, about half an hour ago in this conversation, I asked you, how does life look without your precious booze?
Mm.
And you said these very same things. I can't enjoy a sunset. I go to the mountains and it looks boring. And all that. Depressed. Boring. Disinteresting.
Mm-hmm.
The lower right quadrant is... the dry drunk of Alcoholics Anonymous. This is how they
perceive it,
and this is how they lever people into AA by articulating the addictive voice, which says, If you just quit drinking, you'll have a hole, a void, a deep void in your life. In life, you'll be angry, you'll be irritated, you'll be depressed, and eventually you'll drink again.
That's what they say to you. That's exactly what they say to you.
Eventually, you'll drink again. It's inevitable. Mm-hmm. And even if you didn't drink, you'll probably explode. You'll go crazy, end up in a mental institution.
When my friend came to me, she says, "You're a dry drunk. You need AA."
Yeah, because people can't be happy.
This is full.
Pure, 100% beast, addictive voice. This is what it always says. It doesn't matter if Alcoholics Anonymous exists. This is what the beast was saying back in the 1700s and the 1500s. This is the nature of addiction, the nature of the beast, which says there's life sucks. There's no good to life. But there's this one thing that feels wonderful, and you can enjoy your life
if you drink.
If you just drink, drink, drink. It's good for you.
Yes.
Drink. And there you are. This is appalling that the professions have been so dense, so gullible, so misled, so mistaken.
It's
to tell people that you have to fill the void. See, there's a void in your life without alcohol, and you can't be happy on your own steam. You don't know how to live once you stop drinking. And you have to go to AA and accept their ersatz bad religion in order to stay on the planet.
Well, that and the fact that, you know, Jack, they just don't, they never tell you you can beat it. They never tell you that. They tell you you're going to battle it all your life, and you're gonna fall off the wagon. You're going to relapse. It never says you can do it.
Yeah. Now, do you hear the beast here? Do you hear the beast?
Yes.
And what you just
all
said?
All the way.
That is pure all the way. Beast. Mm-hmm. All the way. So, as the reason I'm delving into this is not because I get a big kick out of knocking AA. That isn't what I'm doing.
No, I understand that completely.
Let me tell you again, just in case you're not clear, why I'm doing this right now with you. You know, time is precious, and I'm spending time really knocking AA, really saying this is bad, this is destructive. When you leave here, you're going to leave here in a day or a couple days, you're going to be all finished. In fact, you're done now. If you never came back, you're okay. But when you are finished here, the weeks and months will start flying by, and you're going to hear a voice in your head, and guess what it's going to be?
You need to go to a meeting.
You need to go to a meeting.
That's all I know that's going to happen. Yeah.
You need to get to a meeting. Your beast is going to be homesick. For your beast, hope springs eternal in AA.
Right.
As long as it's at home with its own species in AA, it has hope that you one day will drink again and have a wonderful relapse. And you're going to hear other things in your head. One is that we'll always be here for you. And they will be. Those drunks, those irresolute drunks, will always be sitting on their folding chairs waiting for you to return. You may come crawling in, bloodied up, your face all out of shape, and they will welcome back. We love you. We're here for you. And your beast doesn't care that your face is out of shape. Your beast doesn't care that you're bloodied up and really messed up because you drank. As long as you drink, it's fine. They want you back. They don't want you to get away and do it on your own. When you explain this to a 12-stepper, they will lay the curse of AA upon you, which is the dry drunk myth.
Right.
So, AA turns out to be an enemy.
Yes.
It is the institution of the beast of addiction. And they want you to fail. They want you to come back.
You're set up to fail, Jack. You know,
exactly.
Totally set up to fail.
They will do all they can to pull you down, to humble you. You must be humbled by self-destruction, your own self-destruction. Yeah. But this is not fun and games. This is not a knock AA for the fun of it type of thing.
No, of course not.
And a lot of people are very perturbed that we are harshly, aggressively critical of AA this way. And the reason that it's this way is that lives are saved when people wake up out of their moral slumber and take control of their own conduct. Yes. Rational Recovery did at one time have groups, and it got to be pretty popular. Mm-hmm. We had up to 1,000 groups at one time around the country.
Right.
And when AVRT grew up into the force that it is today, people scattered. They were like cockroaches. They just disappeared. They got very angry, very upset. So what AVRT is the bell that says, school's out.
Mm-hmm.
Go home.
You can do. You did it.
We believe in you.
Right.
You've done it. Don't keep coming back.
But those people need that. For some reason, they need that.
This is the beast, though, that wants to congregate.
It's right.
Sort of like the watering hole in the desert.
And the oasis,
right. They all come around the watering hole. Interestingly, we've heard bars called the watering hole.
Oh, yeah.
There's a gathering together, a camaraderie that is very common. Yeah, there are biological underpinnings to the whole thing. The idea of gathering together, Bill W. said, we have the herd mentality. This is a great advantage of AA because we have a herd mentality. And this is what it is, where people fortify each other's addictive voices with this group mentality.
Well, I feel really, really good about myself right now. Very confident.
Heard the expression pink cloud?
No.
It's recovery group.
That, okay.
When people, see, a lot of times people go to AA and do something like AVRT when they get started. They're thinking, okay, there's God in the 12 steps. But you know, I'm thinking here, I am never going to drink again, no matter what happens. And they begin to feel good, like you do. Naive in a way, they're innocent, and during the meetings they'll say, boy, I feel so good. Yeah, I'm glad that I came to AA, and it's wonderful to meet nice people here, and I am finished with this addiction. I just feel so good. Thank you very much for helping me and supporting me in my decision that I'll never do this again. And the group will literally, it's like an attack on the person, and they tell the person, oh, you're on a pink cloud. You're setting yourself for a big fall.
I understand. Yeah, I've heard
you
that.
You can't know the ahead. Future.
Yeah,
you're, this
yeah.
is like a honeymoon. You're just having a honeymoon, honey. This is just a honeymoon.
Yeah.
You ain't seen nothing yet. You're setting yourself up for a big fall. Mm-hmm. And this takes away. This is an attack on the moral judgment of an individual. It's an attack on self-confidence, and it keeps people dependent then on AA. So it's very important for you to trust this good feeling that you have. You feel wonderful. And I feel wonderful even today that my addiction is history, and I know how devastating an addiction is until you stop it. So that's part of the reason I feel so good, because I never will have to face that again. But it's not a honeymoon, it's something that you need to trust, find within yourself, and cherish that, fan it, to bring it alive into a flame, because that is you. That's the authentic you. It started out as a young man, all excited about the possibilities of life. Your life on planet Earth. Wow, what a grand experience this is going to be. And then you fell in love with alcohol. And you got sidetracked all these years. Now you've come to a point where you can pick up that original excited kid that you were. Now you're a man. You're more mature than you otherwise would be. You've seen a lot of the dark side of life. A lot of people will say, boy, you started drinking when you were 12 or 7. Or, my goodness, you're a 7-year-old inside, and you're just like a stunted bonsai human here, and you need special counseling to help you to get coping skills because you're just a child. Mm. Emotionally, you're immature because you were drinking. You were frozen in time when you started to drink, and you're just a child now. And nothing could be further from the truth.
Yeah.
You're a very mature, very seasoned man. You've seen a lot of suffering and a lot of good times, too.
Mm-hmm.
And you're ahead of the game. Mm-hmm. You're way ahead of a lot of people who have seen less of life than you have.
And then, you know, gosh, I can enjoy so many things so differently now.
From inside of an addiction, there's a loss of interest
mm-hmm.
in things. Things don't have much of a meaning except that they're what you do when you drink.
Mm-hmm.
And the reordering of your life now is underway. It takes no guidance. Nobody needs to guide you. You know what fun is. You know how, mm-hmm. you know what lights your rocket.
Yes.
And you know very well how to go after those things.
Mm-hmm.
But a lot of people would really believe that you're somehow impaired. You've seen those signs on pickup trucks, no fear.
Mm-hmm.
This is no fear.
Absolutely none.
Yeah.
None left.
Do you have any fear of your beast?
None at all, Jack.
You see how impotent, how...
He's powerless.
Powerless. Pathetic.
Yeah.
So it's an oyster-like thing
you said.
Here, and it just says, feed me, mm-hmm. feed me.
He's going to shrink.
Yeah.
He's going to shrink and shrink and shrink until it goes away.
Yeah.
And when he jumps up and says, hey, I'm back, he'll say, yeah. Hey... No, you're not.
Yeah.
I've got other plans.
Yeah, it's for recognition only. One of the basic strategies is don't respond to it.
Okay.
Don't give it little answers.
Oh.
Because would you do that with an oyster?
No, we wouldn't even talk to an oyster.
Yeah. There's no reason.
No.
We know exactly what it is. We know exactly where it came from. We know exactly what it's up to. And we know that it's totally powerless. And when we hear it, it's good to hear from it.
Okay.
Yeah, when I
can deal with that. Hold just drink, don't answer to it, right?
If I hold a drink,
uh-huh.
yeah, drink a bourbon, my old flame,
mm-hmm.
I can smell it. I don't want to be neutered so that I don't know what that is.
Right, right. I see what you're saying.
I'm a man.
Mm-hmm.
I smell something that once
brings back some interesting memories.
Things and right. brings back some horrible.
Right.
Horrible, horrible things. It's there.
Realize those
yeah,
things.
This is the force of life,
mm-hmm.
and this is a pleasure that I forbid myself.
Mm-hmm.
Always.
Okay.
And when it gets that simple, then it tends to go into the background, and then it'll lurk.
So it will get that simple for me.
Oh, yeah, very quickly.
You know, right now I still feel like, ooh, that little beast is going to come growling out, you know?
Recognition means knowing how impotent it is, recognizing
it's nothing.
Its powerlessness.
Right. Yeah, and see, the thing is, though, Jack, in the past, then that beast comes screaming out. I thought, oh boy, I have no control over this. Let's go have a drink.
Yeah, let's.
Then that beast comes screaming out. I thought, oh boy, I have no control over this. Let's go have a drink.
Yeah, let's. Yeah.
You know, I listened to it. Now I won't.
What do you think it would take to really create a conflict situation where it would be a struggle? What could happen in your life that would set you up?
It would have to be the worst situation in the world, and
like
I don't even see it happening,
worst thing?
If my girl was to die.
Okay. Let me explain something. It should be pleasing. Do you realize how stupid your beast is? This is showdown. The only way it can win is to bluff. And all I did just now is say, I want to see your hand. Because we're going to play some more. Let me see your hand. And it showed me. It's cards. It showed you the card.
That's the worst it could do to me?
Well, it's bad. If the worst should happen and your honey should die, break out the booze. It's time to party.
Oh.
How does your beast feel toward your honey?
I don't think it likes her.
I mean, it just...
Because she doesn't
it
drink.
It just cashed her in.
Because she doesn't your drink.
Beast just cashed so in.
If she died, then the he
big,
could drink.
This is the big chip here.
If she died, then he could drink.
Yeah. So, there. That's what your honey's worth.
Mm.
One drink. Mm-hmm. Do you see the calculus?
Yeah.
This is a cold...
Very calculating little beast.
Wow.
Wow, that's too wild.
Just cashed in your honey for a drink. Wow. What a beastly mentality. You know, some mm-hmm. other dogs will eat their pups for lunch.
Mm-hmm.
And that's common in the animal kingdom. Have a pup for lunch. Hmm. All right. That ain't bad. Do you see why we call it beast?
Yes.
This is a beast.
Totally animalistic.
Yeah, but it can recite Shakespeare if it has to.
Mm-hmm.
It can deal with charts and graphs and all kinds of things. And but that's a crude dude, I'd say. Of course, it would come to you like Dr. Beast and say, oh, you need a little something for your bad
sadness or your whatever, loss.
Yes,
you know.
Your loss, your grieving. Mm-hmm. You need to take a few of these. And
right.
Call me in the morning if you're not drunk. And it's a pathetic mentality that I hope it would generate a little contempt for you to understand this brooding consciousness down there that would play it out that way. It's saying if you lost the most precious thing you can think of in life, you should not feel bad.
You should drink.
You should feel good.
Mm.
I mean, how?
Mm. Yeah.
You should feel this is time to have a party, a little personal party.
Mm-mm.
In the privacy of your room. You should not feel bad.
I don't like that little beast. That really pisses me off.
And that's how, this is a contemptible thing. Just traded in your honey for
it. He likes to try to set me up, too, in the past. You know, it'd be like, okay, you have a few drinks, you know. She'll be coming over later, but you can have a couple of drinks. I set myself up kind of thing, you know. It's like, okay, she doesn't drink. We don't drink together. I don't drink around her.
Mm-hmm.
That's just our agreement when we first met. Then all of a sudden, I started pushing the envelope, you know. I have a couple of drinks. Next thing I know, I'm blasted one night. She comes over. So she, you know, goes home. And we get a big argument, everything else, snowballing. And again, he says, go ahead, have a couple more drinks. You know, she's gone now. She's gone now. You can get hammered tonight.
Mm-hmm. Mm-hmm.
Son of a bitch.
That's how it works. Uses people as bargaining chips.
Yeah, yeah. And if there's nobody around, he can drink.
Mm-hmm.
'Cause you're not hurting anybody.
Well, who would know?
Yeah.
Who?
Nobody but you.
Yeah.
And that's what he says. Nobody but you know, man.
Quite
son
a conversation.
Of a bitch. I you know what? I am really seeing so much, recognizing him so much now.
Yeah. It finally starts.
I never saw in my life, though,
it's
Jack.
Like turning a dimmer up. And finally you can see the outline of the most disgusting creature.
And it is.
Disgusting.
It really is. It's just, there's no, he has no conscience.
No.
Well, my God.
No more in dogs.
Wow.
Animal. Party animal. To your beast, you're the eye in the sky. You are always on duty. You're always watching. You'll have your life will be lived in a stream of consciousness. Your beast will show up in your stream of consciousness. You can think of it as a conveyor belt with a lot of ping pong balls kind of running down a chute. All of a sudden comes a beach ball. And you can't miss it. I mean, it's so conspicuous.
That's what I'm going to start seeing.
See, a lot of people think, well, gee, it's going to start throwing weird curves at me. It's going to, how do I know if this is really my beast?
It's only a beach, obvious.
It's like with big red, yellow, green stripes on it. All these little ping pong balls, that's you, that's your stream of consciousness, and then here comes this beach ball.
Yeah. For 20 years, I haven't seen that.
Yeah.
I never recognized it. And now, just in the 2 days, yeah. I can see that son of a bitch coming.
Oh, yeah. This is the most significant substance in the universe, alcohol.
He makes up so many excuses.
Yeah.
And man, oh man, do I see him out there. Jeez, Chad.
It's shocking.
Yeah.
There's a...
things I've done.
Recovery shock.
Yeah. God.
Yeah, it's recovery shock.
That's just disgusting, though.
AVRT is a very abrupt experience where all of a sudden you've been living in this never end, living in the dark, and now we switch on the lights, and it's shocking to see where you've been, what's been governing your life.
The lies I've told myself.
And who's been telling them to you.
Yeah.
It's shocking.
Too much. Just too much. At least I know. At least I know what those were.
You got it.
Yeah.
You have gotten it. And as I said before, you're right on time. Yeah, this is the way that we do it. Now, your beast has a duty to perform. It's a legitimate life force. This is your body attempting to survive. It's a part of your body that still has a biological script error that says alcohol is necessary for survival. Mm-hmm. It's an error. Once again, you've hit it with a barrage. It's a literal barrage. It's practically, for all intents and purposes, destroyed. But living things do not want to die.
Right.
So it has a duty, a biological duty, to survive. So tonight, it has to reorganize itself. It can't do this, can't do that. You've gotten to the point now of laughing at it.
Mm-hmm.
And it's got to do something. It will not give up as long as there's an ounce of life left in it. And we don't want it to die, ultimately. We want to beat it into a submissive state with the intent to kill. We show it no mercy.
Right.
Because we know that no matter how merciless we are, it's not going to die. So this evening, it'll regroup. It may be quiet for periods of time, but I want you to listen to it. There's a thing in AVRT that we call aggressive listening. It's kind of leaning into it. Say, I want to hear this. I want to hear... Why should I drink more alcohol in this lifetime?
Mm-hmm.
And you wait. It'll talk to you. How sure am I really? And you wait. And it'll talk to you. And by listening aggressively, you can force its hand because it's dumb. It's playing showdown poker. And when you do this, all you're saying is, I want to see more of your hand. If you don't mind, I'd like to see your cards. And it'll show you. It's so dumb. It doesn't have any choice. It'll start showing you more cards, more of its true character. And every time it happens, just take note of what it teaches you. It's a very dumb thing, but it still is a worthy opponent. It has the capacity to string together new causal pathways in your thought processes. New connections, mm-hmm. new ideas. I had one fellow come back about this stage along the way. He found himself thinking about his health. He wasn't sure of his health. And he thought that maybe he had liver problems,
mm-hmm.
and that he had a progressive cirrhosis that would not get better. And he started worrying that he might die
mm-hmm.
from this condition. And he wanted to get tests, lots of tests. And he kept thinking about tests. I have to get liver tests. And the... interesting things, I asked him, well, supposing you get the bad news, that you really do have this thing that you're worried about, then what? He says, well, then there's no point in quitting drinking. No. And
that's interesting.
The interesting thing, I said, well, supposing you find out that you have a really nice, pink, healthy liver. Nothing wrong with it.
That is just, well, what's the point? I just don't have to stop drinking because it's healthy.
Yeah.
That's the little beast making all sorts of excuses. Either way, it's going to work for him.
So now the beast has a marvelous ability to argue both sides
of the fence.
Of all arguments. Doesn't matter what the argument is.
Well.
Here, you can open them.
Smell of
pick it up.
There. Smell of what does it have? The scent of rotten eggs or something to that effect. It just it reminds me of.
It's distinctive.
Mm-hmm.
That is distinctive.
Some good times, some bad.
Yeah. How does that affect you to smell that?
It doesn't bother me at all right now. It just brings back some memories, is all.
Mm-hmm.
You know, I'm not.
Let your beast take a look at it. Let your beast get involved with that.
Mm.
You know how that would taste.
Mm-hmm.
Mm-hmm.
Let's take a drink of it, but
you feel the attraction.
Mm-hmm.
It's a pretty strong attraction.
It doesn't feel very strong right now.
What's your beast get revved up?
My beast isn't very attracted to alcohol in the mornings.
It's not morning.
It seems to him right now, even though it's noon. I had never drank before, say, 5 o'clock even. And it's just not something that even attracts the beast right now.
You haven't had a drink for
right
days now.
Pardon me?
You haven't had a drink for days.
No, it doesn't matter.
Yeah.
It doesn't matter whether I had a drink yesterday or this morning. I would not drink at this time because of... The beast never has.
Mm-hmm.
So it's not attractive to him.
Your beast has never had to. And your beast is ultimately oblivious to time.
Mm-hmm.
You've set up certain rules that, that are quite agreeable to the beast. But right now, your beast is very capable of getting very excited about that.
Mm.
It doesn't have
I'm not letting him then, huh?
Yeah. There's still this it's a mask. Of your own rules about drinking. You don't drink under these circumstances, but you do drink. So your beast is respectful.
Okay.
It's a mask of rules. Beneath the surface, your beast is just as fired up for that drink right now as at any other time.
Hmm.
If we were to set the clock to 6 or 7, that would be quite all right. But go ahead and let your beast get fired up. It's time. It's time to drink. Feel it?
I just can't, for some reason, I just can't get excited about it.
Well, you can't.
I mean, if I can't, I can't seem to let him loose enough to get excited.
Okay, your beast is wanting to stay aloof. It doesn't want to be jerked around.
Mm-hmm.
It hates that.
Mm-hmm.
I think that it would be worth going ahead and forcing
really pulling it out.
Yeah,
huh?
Yeah, force it out. You can get it. See, I never Frank never will, but if I get into it, that it's just there. It's an arousal of desire.
I see what you're saying.
It's there. Let the good times roll.
Mm-hmm.
It just comes right out.
Mm-hmm. Yeah, it does.
See, we're not playing by rules. One thing we have to understand about the beast is it plays by no rules. So it's using your rules to try to avoid detection and exposure here.
Trying to stop me from bringing him out.
So we're breaking the rules here.
Mm-hmm.
Say, yeah, it's early in the day, but
whether we realize it or not, we're going to pull him out.
We're going to change the rules and yank him out again just to be cruel, just to teach it a lesson.
Yeah.
But we are in control.
Yeah, I really want to drink that right now, you know.
It
really wants to drink that right
does,
now.
It does. Yeah, mm-hmm. It is all set to go.
Yeah, and the smelling of it and the just having it in my hand and kind of caressing it and really getting a good whiff of it.
Yeah,
really brought it out.
Yeah, it's all excited.
Mm-hmm.
It's all excited.
Mm-hmm.
And that's the way it's going to be for the rest of your life, and
mm-hmm.
I told you it's been decades since I've had anything.
Mm-hmm.
And there's that memory. Once you've been into it, you don't forget it.
Mm-mm.
Pleasure sticks.
Yeah.
Pain disappears. The most painful things in your life cannot really be remembered. You remember that you were in pain. You remember the horror, the fear. You remember that you had those emotions, but you cannot remember the actual pain. But the pleasure...
always.
Mm-hmm. It's right there.
Yeah.
Your beast can see it. Your beast wants to drink it.
Mm-hmm.
And you can see something ugly.
Mm-hmm.
So see the beautiful beer.
Mm-hmm.
See the ugly beer.
No problem.
Take a whiff in your right mind. This is Tom.
Yeah.
It's not...
It stinks.
It really does stink.
Yeah.
Just a minute ago, I was smelling it nicely.
Mm-hmm.
And when I do it this way, it doesn't have that.
Right. Because of the mouth-watering thing. I mean, just right now, my mouth just watered just because I was just thinking about it again, let the beast come out.
It's a little bit like...
really good.
Do you see the similarity between sexual desire and this?
Mm-hmm. Mm-hmm.
That there's an arousal.
Yes.
That there's a...
it brings out a certain part of you.
It's biological.
Mm-hmm.
It's nothing to fear. It's
excitable.
And it's nothing to fear.
No.
We don't fear our sexual desires. We have them. Many are inappropriate. Some people become celibate with good reason. They just simply write it off, sometimes for religious reasons or personal reasons. You just say, well, I'm just not going to do that anymore. And that's the end of it. You were talking earlier that there are a lot of different feelings that you have in your life, and that you're beast, your addictive voice has feelings. There's feelings that come to you that you can feel irritated or depressed. There's a whole lot of feelings that are part of your addictive voice and direct you toward drinking.
Yeah, usually loneliness, you know, things like that. Then all of a sudden it started getting to the point where, you know, I didn't have to make any excuses anymore why to drink.
Mm-hmm.
You know, it was just, hey, I'm going to do it, whether I'm alone, lonely, sad, happy, depressed, ecstatic, it doesn't matter. And making those excuses. I consider them excuses to drink. It was just the beast saying, hey, you know what? You're going to drink whatever I tell you to.
Mm-hmm.
And I listened to him. I let him control it, you know. And this is why I'm here, to learn how to control him. And I can see there's going to be some trouble areas, battle with him still, but not as hard.
What do you picture, say, like in battle, conflict over it? What situations?
Late at night, alone, sitting there watching TV, or a boxing match or something like that, that would be when he really wants a drink. And that's when I have to face him and win.
So you're alone watching TV.
Mm-hmm. That's the worst time.
Mm-hmm.
I know that's when he's going to come out.
You're right. And your beast can show you a picture of you losing.
I'm not going to, though.
No.
And I've already told myself that.
And you can show yourself a picture of you
winning.
Winning.
Mm-hmm. And I will win.
Mm-hmm.
Once he regroups, and like you said he was going to do tonight, I've already made my decision.
Mm-hmm.
There's no going back on it because of my morality. It's going to stand there,
mm-hmm,
strong.
Yeah.
It's just that I do see it being a bit tough.
For
me.
You?
Just for some reason.
See,
it's that doubt thing. He keeps on putting that doubt back in me, you know?
See, you're experiencing, which is good, you're experiencing this this vacillation. There's something going on.
Conflict, yeah.
Yeah. And you're right, there is going to be a struggle. And it is going to be difficult. Definitely. But there's two of you. And for which one of you is it going to be difficult?
The beast.
It's going to be horrible.
He's going to hate me.
Yeah.
I don't care. It's going to be really hard on him. On it.
Yeah.
I don't care. It's going to be really hard on him. On it. Yeah. Yeah.
So, if you keep in mind, you see what your beast has put you through.
Mm-hmm.
The beast and all of us little helpers in, mm-hmm, AA. It's put you through, it's really ripped off your life. So when you feel it struggling, how do you feel? How do you feel?
I feel pretty good about it.
Because you got this enemy into a pathetic, defensive
mode.
Yeah. Exactly.
I feel pretty good about it, but then, you know, if I let the beast part, if I feel what he feels, or let that happen, then I get in trouble.
Well, see, you can feel the suffering,
yeah,
of this thing inside of,
yeah,
you.
Yeah.
It's there. You can, mm-hmm, feel it suffer.
Mm-hmm.
And you can gloat. See, that there's a cruelty that you're inflicting on the beast that's been destroying you. So when you feel it cringe and suffer, you can take great pleasure.
Good. Okay. Instead of feeling sorry for it.
Yeah, yeah. This is no mercy.
Right.
You said no mercy.
None.
This is the enemy. And you want it to suffer.
Yes.
Now, when you are gratified by seeing your beast suffer, there's another feeling that you can get. Which is what? How do you feel when you prevail?
God, just great.
Yeah, now this
wonderful.
This is the way it goes now in AVRT. Yep, you're going to be alone, either tonight or tomorrow night or whenever it is. It'll be late at night, the TV's on, and you're out of beer. And your beast says, "Arrgh, you need beer." And you're going to, like you are right now, yeah.
Screw you.
I don't drink.
Right.
I quit. Do that. And it's going to struggle.
Mm-hmm.
You'll feel it. You've seen these science fiction things where something crawls,
yeah,
under the skin of that.
Yeah.
That's the way it is. It crawls. And when you feel it struggle, there's another emotion that comes out. Hey, I'm winning. Mm-hmm. I've won. I've defeated it. And then you are shifted. See, as soon as you do that, you're recognizing it and going back over to you. So it'll struggle very briefly until you realize that this struggling feeling is a wonderful sign. Not only are you in good health, but you're safe.
Mm-hmm.
You're safe from it. It's a good feeling. You can only have one feeling at a time.
Mm-hmm.
So as soon as you recognize the struggle, that flips you into you.
That's what I'm going to do tonight.
Yeah. Do you understand this now?
Yeah, I see.
The act of recognition flips you.
Right.
Right into your right mind.
Okay. So when I'm dealing with this as it comes up, as I know it will, you know, like you said, we're going to have this little confrontation tonight. You know, there's no doubt.
Yeah, no doubt.
And tonight is going to be the night because I'm going to be at home alone,
right.
And it's going to happen. I'm going to make sure I just did just what you explained just now.
Yeah. The act of recognition flips you
right
into your right mind.
Yeah,
very good. Okay, we're at the end of our session for today.
That's what's going to happen tonight. I'm looking forward to it.
Yeah.